medicine about it, so also some clinical products, I think, as well. So delighted to be here today. My name is Claire Lewis, and I'm one of the lecturers in the School of Nursing. And today I want to share with you the results of some work that I have been leading on recently, where we've used simulation to teach end-of-life care to undergraduate nursing and medical students here within the university. My background is, clinical background is in cancer nursing, palliative care, end-of-life care, and that's also where my academic interests lie. And presently I am responsible for the delivery of the end-of-life education in first year in the undergraduate nursing programme. And that has traditionally taken form of didactic approaches, large group lectures and small group tutorials. And from delivering that content, from delivering the large group lectures and feedback I get from students in small group tutorials, what I consistently hear from students is that end of life care is one of those areas of practice where they have a lot of anxieties about. We have a lot of students who come in from school, 18, 19 perhaps, who might not have had any experience either personally or professionally with death. And it does cause a lot of apprehension and concern. They're in here for 6 weeks of university and then they're out for clinical placement where they will potentially be exposed to death and dying. A number of the fears that I hear from students include things such as how to communicate with families and patients, what to say, or sometimes even more importantly, what not to say. Their own emotional reaction to death, either because they may have had a bereavement in the past or because they have never had any experience of caring for the dying. And some of the practical issues that is involved with end-of-life care, such as symptom management, some of those very complex symptoms at end of life, and practical issues such as care of the body after death. Consistently getting feedback year on year about their fears. And these fears from our own students are also echoed in the literature about death and dying. And this literature is probably, you know, consistently, perhaps for the past two decades, there has been evidence to suggest that nursing students still have a fear of caring for the dying. And that's not just specific to our nursing students, that's also including our medical colleagues. They've reported feelings of anxiety, of helplessness, of powerlessness, of emotional distress whenever they're faced with that experience. And there have been reports from nurses who are also just recently qualified that they do feel inadequately prepared to provide that quality care at end of life that patients and families deserve. Medical students similarly have reported feeling out of their depth whenever they're caring for dying patients and their families. So this is across the spectrum of medical students and nursing students. What we do know, and what the literature also tells us though, is that nurses and doctors who have more experience with care of the dying, with people who are terminally ill, they have a more favourable attitude towards end-of-life care because they've got more experience of it. And there's also evidence to suggest that that experience also increases their confidence and their competence whenever they are delivering end-of-life care at that very emotive and sensitive time for patients and families. So what we need to think about then is how we can provide that experience to students, to our undergraduate nursing and medical students. Ideally, that would be in the form of clinical placement whenever they're out in practice. But we also have to think about whenever they're in university and we're giving them the education in here in our university programme, what way can we provide teaching to them that is giving them more hands-on experience and is actually getting them more actively involved in their learning. Unfortunately, depending on where students are in placement, they may get a limited opportunity to be involved in end-of-life care. And that is also exacerbated by some evidence that would suggest that mentors actively shield or protect students from the care of the dying, from families who are experiencing a bereavement or for patients who are dying because they think that they're protecting students, but in actual fact they're limiting their exposure and their opportunity to learn. We already know that simulation can provide that experiential learning that it can replicate as close to clinical practice as well, what we hope we can get within the university. In a landmark study undertaken in America in 2014, simulation within nursing education in any college was demonstrated to provide experiences and outcomes which are comparable to that clinical placement. So, as educators, we're looking more towards the use of simulation to try to provide that experiential and active learning for our undergraduate nursing and medical students. So there has been, whilst the literature is, you know, while we know that simulation works, there is a very small body of evidence which has started looking at simulation for end-of-life care. And most of that has been undertaken in America, but again, it's very limited. There was a systematic review done by Gillen and others in 2014 into the use of simulation to teach end-of-life care, and they only defined six studies, two mixed methods, two pilot studies and two qualitative studies which have actually used simulation. But what those studies found was that students engaged with it, they found it very useful, it increased their ability to relate their theory to practice, and it gave them that hands-on experience that they maybe were craving or that they didn't get in their clinical placements. So there is an increased emphasis now on the use of simulation in end-of-life care, but there is a dearth of evidence from the UK, and the systematic review that was undertaken in 2014 when we looked at nursing education, there has been very little done in the way of incorporating medical students and using an interprofessional approach in the simulation teaching. So that really led me to think about using simulation to teach end-of-life care. We already in the School of Nursing are fortunate enough to have a dedicated simulation suite and a dedicated programme of education incorporating interprofessional education. So it really made sense that given my own academic interest and background in end-of-life care and my teaching into the simulation programme that we look to combine the two. Considering the growing evidence to suggest this is a very viable approach to teaching end-of-life care. So it was at the end of last year, I got together a research team which consisted of our Director of Education, Marion Traynor, a lecturer in cancer nursing, Joanne Reid, and we also invited a third-year nursing student and a fourth-year medical student to be on the research team. We got together to think about how we could put together a programme where we could test the use of simulation to teach end-of-life care. And we were very fortunate at that stage to be awarded the Teaching Innovation grant from the School of Nursing to enable this pilot study to be conducted. So we put an application for ethical approval. We got ethical approval at the start of this year in February. And initially we looked to recruit third year nursing students and fourth year medical students as our sample population to target. And the reason why we went for third year was because third year nursing students, because they may already have, they definitely would have the theory behind end-of-life care, and they might already have enough experience to bring to it. And fourth year medical students, on the advice of our colleagues in the medical education side, where they would have had their theoretical module and their oncology module, which would have introduced them to concepts of palliative care. So they were our target population, and we had two main aims from the study. We wanted to look at how effective simulation could be as a teaching approach. So the first aim was to evaluate the use of simulation to teach end-of-life care to undergraduate nursing and medical students. But we didn't just want to end there, because we know that simulation is a very viable approach to teaching, and students tend to like simulation regardless of the content that you're actually teaching, because they can get active learning. So what we wanted to see was, could we actually make a difference to the attitudes of these students towards end-of-life care as a result of the simulated intervention? So our second objective really from this study was to measure the students' attitudes towards end-of-life care before and then after the simulated intervention, using a tool which is shortened to FATCOT, which is a not the best shortened acronym, but it stands for From Attitudes Towards Care of the Dying, Part B. So we'll talk a bit about that tool just as we go through. This VACOD tool is a validated tool which is designed to measure non-family caregivers' attitudes towards providing care to those who are terminally ill and their families. And Catherine Fromelt, who designed this tool, considers somebody who's a non-family caregiver to be any professional or non-professional that's outside of the patient's family. It consists of 30 Likert-type items, which are scored on a 5-point scale. So students had to mark whether they strongly disagree, uncommitted, agree, or strongly agree with the items that were listed on the VACOD. It consisted of equal numbers of positively and negatively worded items, and a higher score on the VACOD indicated a more positive attitude towards end-of-life care. And the maximum score that students that you could get on the tool was 150. So we sought to, we administered the VACOD before the intervention whenever the students came to the simulated session, and then we also administered it afterwards. This is an example of some of the items, you know, there's 30 items that are in it, but just an example of some of the items the students would have had to answer based on their attitude. So things like, I would be uncomfortable talking about impending death of a dying person. I would not want to care for a dying person. Family should be involved in the physical care of the dying person if they want to, and care should extend to the family of the dying person. So this has been used with undergraduate populations previously, and it was one of the tools that was available for us to actually measure their own attitudes towards the provision of care as opposed to their own experience of death. I'll to go through actually some of the results, but it was found some limitations to it, which I'll discuss at the end, but overall it did quite nicely with our study. The actual study itself, we, as a research team, we got together, and because we had student involvement in the research team in the form of the medical students and the nursing students, we sought to get together as a team and come up with scenarios. And those scenarios were based on feedback from students and the literature about some of the most common challenges that they would face whenever they're in clinical practice. They were really designed to reflect some of the more challenging situations that not only undergraduate students would be put in, but also qualified staff and registered staff. So I have an example of the two scenarios that we tested out. They really were quite challenging, I think, for any healthcare professional to be faced with, never mind an actual undergraduate student. In our traditional simulation setup, the way we sort of formulate our session is that students observe a scenario and they take part in the scenario. So not only do they get to be involved in one, but they also learn by watching their peers take part in the session. So we decided to keep that format for this study. So students were told in their invitation letter that they would only be expected to take part in one simulated session, but they would be expected to observe their colleagues. Through the financial support of the Teaching Innovation Award, I was very fortunate to be able to employ simulated patients from the School of Medicine and Dentistry, and we used them to role play the family members. We used, for the actual simulation, we used our high fidelity mannequin as the patient, and I'll show you some photographs of that in case you're unfamiliar with that actual mannequin that we use. So the simulated patients were really used to play the family members because we wanted these scenarios to be as realistic as possible. At end of life care and palliative care, the family are very much part of that, so we wanted to make sure that the family were there. And often some of the challenges from students that were reported, it was not about how to actually care for the patient, it was about how they communicate with the family and care for the family as well. Once the simulated session was 20 minutes long, roughly, we decided to keep it to a maximum 20 minutes so students wouldn't be overwhelmed whenever they were in the simulation suite, undertaking the actual simulated clinical experience. Once that finished, then we had quite a thorough period of debriefing afterwards. That was very important in order to get the students to reflect on their actions, to discuss their decision-making, to discuss how they worked as a team, how they communicated with each other. Also things such as their situational awareness, so they're aware of what's going on around them. So that debriefing was critical in that the period after the simulated experience, and the debriefing was undertaken by members of the research team, the staff members of the research team who have a background in simulation, end of life care, and also one of our research team has a master's in counselling. So we were very much able to provide a supportive environment for the students afterwards to reflect on their actions. So questions in the debrief were along the lines of what went well, what did you base your decisions on? Is there anything you would do differently? How do you feel you acted with your colleagues, and how do you feel your teamwork was? So they were able to reflect on how they performed in their session. We decided to test two scenarios, and we decided to go from sort of one spectrum to where somebody's getting the diagnosis that maybe perhaps they're now moving towards a more palliative approach to their care, right up to then another scenario, which was whenever the person was very much actively dying, and the simulator was actively dying, then scenario two. So scenario one was a patient called Valerie Black, and she was 62, and one of the simulated patients was employed to play her husband, who was John Black. Valerie had a history of ovarian cancer, stage 3, which she had been diagnosed with in 2012. And she had been treated in the past with surgery and chemotherapy. So before the students went into the simulated experience, they were given a handover about Valerie. Now, there's a lot of words in this slide, but basically they were given a bit of a handover to set the scene. And they were told that Valerie had been coming up to a regular appointment, but she had been feeling quite symptomatic of nausea, bloating, constipation, abdominal pain. And when she attended for her appointment at the oncology clinic, her consultant wanted to admit her for further investigations with a query that she was obstructing. So she attended for an urgent CT, and the report from the CT showed that she had disease progression and that she had a partial bowel obstruction. She wasn't a suitable candidate for surgery and wasn't for further treatment, and really the plan now was for conservative management. So she was going to be just managed palliative care and kept comfortable and symptom management at this stage. So Dr. Jones, who was a consultant, had informed her clinic that morning, and they were told really that there was no further treatment, comfort was a priority, and just really to keep Valerie comfortable. So in the simulated experience, the nursing student is the person who gets the handover, and they are the first person who goes into the room. So this was the handover that was given to the nurse whenever she's accepting Valerie into her care. And we try to emphasise in this scenario really that feeling from the family and from the husband and from Valerie about the shock of getting that information. And we had instructed the simulated patient to, we give them some lines, like a script, so as they would be able to have a consistent approach per scenario. But they were instructed to really act that shock state where they had made the clinic appointment and all they had heard was no further options for treatment. But they were now asking lots of questions once they were in the care in the ward. They were asking the nurse lots of questions about, the doctor mentioned palliative care, what is palliative care, will Valerie be feeling like this all the time, why has she got these symptoms, will they improve, can we get her home? Some of those awkward questions that they might be faced with. And you can see that we'd set the simulator up to try to make it look as realistic as possible. Obviously Valerie's looking slightly masculine, and we can't really change anything about the sim man, but we had her in her headscarf to represent the fact that she had chemo and she maybe lost her hair. We had the wider room was set up to look a bit like a side room with some magazines and water and such on the table to mimic a side room that the students would be familiar with as much as possible. And the scenario with Valerie really took the lines of having to explain what palliative care is to families and explain that try to interpret some of that information. Valerie also needed symptom management because she was having pain, she was having nausea, and they also needed to look at her symptom management as well. So whenever the nursing student felt that it was beyond her remit to deal with Valerie, then that's whenever she phoned for the medical student to come in and assist her. And whenever the medical student came in, then they were responsible for doing a symptom assessment and also then reinforcing some of the information that had been given to Valerie and her husband that morning in clinic. We found it was quite interesting to see that a number of students, you know, veered away from the question about what is palliative care. They felt uncomfortable telling them that it was, whenever your symptom management now, whenever there's a kind of curative approach for your treatment or for your disease. They veered away from some of those uncomfortable questions and focused quite a lot on what they could do physically for Valerie, as opposed to trying to give some answers to a lot of the questions that the simulated patient had and that Valerie had. Scenario two went to the other end of that spectrum, where we had a patient who was very much actively dying. And this patient was called John Smith, and he was 58 with stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer. He also had bone and liver metastases and had been getting a course of palliative radiotherapy and chemotherapy. He had his wife with him, who was Mary, who was played by our simulated patients, and he had one daughter who lived in Australia, who wasn't there at the time, but was on her way home, and once she knew that her father was starting to move to actively dying phase. Again, the handover the students got about John was that he had been admitted with a chest infection, exacerbation of pain and breathlessness, and since admission to the ward, the medical ward, he was on, his condition had just progressively deteriorated to the point where he was now unconscious and actively dying. In this scenario, Mary was very versed on her husband's condition, very aware of what was happening, and we had instructed the simulated patient to role play the wife, somebody who wanted a lot of information, wanted to know what was happening, what would happen next, what do I need to look for, and also was asking questions about do you think he'll be here tomorrow? My daughter has to come home. She's coming home. She'll be arriving tomorrow. Do you think he'll be here? Do you think he'll still be alive tomorrow? You know, what are you looking for? So this was really focusing on actively managing the symptoms of dying and looking at signs of dying. So John was commencing syringe driver to manage his pain and midazolam for breathlessness. And you can see in this scenario we had a bit of a change then in the side room. We had John in bed, unconscious, the curtains closed, soft lighting on to try to represent a nice, soft, relaxing atmosphere for somebody who's approaching end of life. And we were also able to, I took a video of this. Whenever we were thinking about doing the simulation, we used the high fidelity mannequin, and the first scenario, the high fidelity mannequin could have been replaced with another simulated patient. But in this scenario, we were actually able to mimic that sort of rattly breathing and chain stroke breathing that a patient might present with at end of life using the technology. And I've got a video of that, which I'm hoping will play for you. So as you can get an idea of how we were able to mimic that. So you can see that we had a catheter in, which was dark tea in the catheter, to sort of mimic a very dark, concentrated urine at end of life. We had a syringe driver, so as the students would be familiar with the syringe driver and how to troubleshoot to manage the symptoms. And we had things like family photographs, one of his own blankets, his own throw, to try to add that personalised touch that students might be familiar with if they were in the side room of a patient who was dying. With John, the the simulated patient, the wife, was really the key person in this. John had bubbly breathing and was chain stroking, and his wife was active, really concerned about this breathing. Was it distressing him? Was it troubling him? So whenever the nursing student was the first person to go into the room, we had instructed the simulated patient to really emphasise her concern about her husband's breathing, and we wanted our nursing student to reassure the wife about that nature of his rapidly breathing, and then also then consult with her medical colleagues to see if there's anything that they could do to manage that. But really the emphasis on this was with the patient's wife, and the students really had to engage with her and reassure her that her husband was not being troubled by the breathing at the stage, and explain what was causing this bubbly breathing, the rattly breathing. And then the scenario moved on to the wife asking lots of questions about, you know, how do we know whenever time's getting closer? Do you think he'll still be here tomorrow? How can you tell? What are you looking for? So really the student then had to very sensitively discuss the signs of death with the family member and reassure them but not put a time frame, and to give false hope that perhaps John might still be alive for her daughter coming home from Australia the next day. So the we had a period of debrief, as I mentioned, after each scenario, and then students were asked, once the entire session was over, to complete an evaluation form of the teaching, and then also to complete the fact quantum again once the simulation had finished. This was a pilot study, and we had 19 students participating in it, which 15 nursing students and 4 medical students. Unfortunately, we had a lot more interest in the study than what we had, than the numbers that actually took part. Trying to get the timetable of the third year nursing students and fourth year medical students to meet and match where we could get them both at a time when it was appropriate to bring them in for simulation was very difficult. And we were also working within other time constraints. So whenever we had agreed on the use of the simulation suite, so whenever we had agreed on a date, unfortunately it clashed with a number of the medical students being out on an attachment. Some of them did come in from an attachment, but others maybe were not McGelvin or Enniskillen, and it just wasn't viable for them to travel. So that was probably reflected in our numbers, but the interest that I had in the study certainly far outweighed the amount of students who actually came to take part in the simulation. So they completed their FACPOD before and afterwards, and the evaluation was really based on our standard teaching evaluation that we use in school, with some tweaks to make it more appropriate to the simulation and the interprofessional aspect of it. And it consisted of 13 Likert questions, again, strongly agree, strongly disagree, and then also some open response questions about what went well about the simulation and what was the least satisfactory aspect of it. The FACPOD data, first of all, to look at the attitudes of the undergraduate nursing and medical students, I report on primarily. The baseline scores for the FACPOD ranged from 100 to 141. So 150 is the maximum score that you can get on this, and I think even looking at our baseline scores, we had an overall quite positive attitude to end-of-life care even before intervention. And you can see that the scores then, baseline 100 to 141, and then post-intervention scores range from 113 to 145. The mean for the group pre the intervention was 119.6, and the post-intervention mean was 128.4. And whenever we applied a t-test to that, a paired t-test, it was found that that was a significant difference in the score before and after the intervention, indicating that students had a more positive attitude towards end of life as a result of the end of life simulation. All but two students had an increase in their actual score before and after the intervention. And 26 items within the FACPOD out of 30 had an increase in their mean scores. Whenever I looked on closer analysis at those, some of the reasons why, some of the reasons why I believe that there may have been a decrease in score was because some of the items in the fat pot actually use a double negative. So instead of saying I would want to care for a dying person, I would not want to care for a dying person, and that can sometimes cause a bit of confusion. But that wasn't the case for every item. It may be that perhaps people who have never had an end-of-life experience maybe had an increase in their anxiety or concern as a result of this, but that didn't come out in any of the open-ended responses that we had. So trying to explain why there was some questions which had a decrease in score or some students which had an overall decrease in score, we're really just making assumptions because we don't have anything to confirm that. So we had three items of the decrease and then one remained the same. So you can see again the use of the not there, and the dying person should not be allowed to make decisions about his or her physical care. So maybe it added a bit of confusion in whenever the students were answering that. In relation to the teaching evaluation then, this was very positive. We had some very positive reports back from this. 95% of the participants strongly agreed that it helped develop their communication skills and that it was useful to have the actors role play the family members. 95% also agreed that the feedback from the facilitators was very useful in the debriefing period. 89% agreed it was a useful learning exercise and that it was a safe learning environment for them to put their skills into practice, and that the debriefing helped them reflect on their actions. And 84% strongly agreed that it helped them apply their knowledge. In the open-ended responses, some of the information was very strong. You know, it was great to see as somebody who's an interest in end-of-life education and promoting this and using simulation to try to give them more experiential learning. You can see there, I find the whole simulation session very beneficial. I like that nursing students and medical students work together and the actors role play the family members. And I felt it was a very realistic and very supportive environment. Least satisfactory, very little to be honest. I would be keen to do another scenario if possible, so they were actively looking for more. Least satisfactory, watching myself back in video. We videoed this debriefing, or sorry, we videoed the simulation, the 20 minutes of the simulated experience, to use in the debriefing so students could reflect on their actions and so we could show them key points that we felt would benefit from learning from. Students don't tend to like themselves in video and they don't like watching themselves. You know, it's not just students, we all tend to not like it. So that was one of the things that they found the least satisfactory about it. But it was very beneficial because students and ourselves, we sometimes don't know what we're doing or the way we're approaching somebody or our body language until we actually see ourselves back. So the video we found was very useful in the debriefing, but some of the students didn't appreciate seeing themselves back in video. And the least satisfactory, having treatment room and patient room in the same room made it very difficult to communicate whilst prepping treatments. And really this is just a physical environment aspect of the simulation speech, where students were saying that if they were phoning a doctor to provide information or getting drawn up a syringe driver or drawn up medications, they wouldn't be right beside the patient. And our simulated patients, sometimes whenever they were asking questions, they were interrupting the student while they were trying to do a task, so they felt that it would be more beneficial if there was a room that they could go to and would be more realistic, but unfortunately we don't have that facility. How could it be improved? Common themes included a brief overview beforehand of what's involved in palliative care, as students have no experience in end-of-life care, and also maybe more information. But I think really, from this thing that came out, this just shows exactly why we need this, because you can see there, more information, they want more information about it. Some students have no experience. And this is the whole reason why we're doing this, to give them that experience. So, and they do get theory, they do get theory in first and second year. So I think just really this summed up, this least satisfactory part summed up for how can we improve. Really summed up the reason why we're doing this. And just any other comments? Simulation is a good learning tool for visual learners like myself. Fantastic experience, and I feel the best way to learn vital skills. fantastic, would really help nurses for placement. So some really positive comments that come out of the evaluation. And that is in keeping with simulation in general, and students tend to really enjoy simulation and getting that opportunity to put their skills into practice. But thankfully they enjoy the end of life aspect of it in this case. The simulated patients weren't actually asked to give feedback as part of the study, but afterwards they did get emails from some of the simulated patients to comment on the experience and to give feedback on our students, and it was overwhelmingly very, very positive. One of the simulated patients emailed me to say that the students' commitment to the role play was wonderful. In the afternoon session especially, I felt a tremendous sense of concern and confidence from the students who treated Mary with such compassion and respect. I think there was 8 simulated patients used in total, and their feedback was very overwhelmingly positive. And also, a student emailed me as well after the session. Whilst we did take comments in the form of evaluation, I also had a number of students email me again after the session. And this is just an example of one. I hope the university will do more simulations. They're so worthwhile and I've learnt so much today. It is great we can practice in the same environment and the debriefing was so positive and helpful. I've learned so much and I'm so glad I took part. This actual student who got in touch with me about a month later, I met her at an open day here, and she had said that previous to the end of life simulation, she had been working in a ward and they had a patient who had been there for quite a while, and he was end of life, and she had always avoided that room. She said that she avoided going into that room because she was concerned about how to approach the patient and their family. And she said that as a result of the simulation, she felt a lot more confidence and she was able to go in and engage with the family and the patient. And at the end of that family's experience in that ward, they gave her a note and a letter to thank her for her care. And in that letter they said that that she had restored their faith in nursing. So she was really positive about this, and I think, you know, if there's that, even that one feedback that has come back from it, if it's made a difference to even one family or patient, then I think, you know, it really speaks volumes for it. There were a number of limitations to this. It was a pilot study, so obviously very small numbers. So caution whenever we're thinking about statistical inference from it. The evaluations in the FATCOD tool were anonymous, so we couldn't actually make distinctions between the professions. And again, as I mentioned previously, the double negatives in the FATCOD certainly a limitation. We had no control to compare against standard teaching, so whilst they really benefited from this, we don't know how it compared to what they actually got as standard. But really, in light of the limitations, this small pilot study in this sample, but the simulation had a positive impact on the attitudes of undergraduate nursing and medical students towards end-of-life care. Simulation is a viable, innovative approach to teaching death and dying to that student group. And I think really what comes from this is that we need to look at larger studies to really test this properly. And also then to see, does this make a difference in practice? Because whilst the students have positively evaluated it, it looks like they've had a change in attitude. Is that reflected in clinical practice? How can we, is there any way that we can actually measure the impact of something like simulation on end of life whenever they go out and they're dealing with real patients and families? Just to end, I'd like to just make some acknowledgements to our research team, to our third year nursing student and fourth year medical student who gave up their time to come and volunteer to be part of this. Their input was vital to making sure that we kept grounded and we were very in tune with what the students needed in this study. Thanks to the Skilled Nursing Midwifery, not only for the teaching animation work, but also for access to students, and the same for the School of Medicine and Dentistry. And huge thanks to the students and the simulated patients who took part in this. Just briefly, the families of our Mary, or John and Valerie, were very grateful to our students for their care. So they wanted to say thanks to them. So